I'm ready when you are.
You can feel the country's on a knife edge. It's only, what, 30 minutes late starting?
Let's do this!
It's a joke, obviously.
You are in for a treat. We're not rioting yet.
I don't like that question.
You're just saying shit and you don't even know what you're talking about.
That spider goat sounds way cooler than manta rays, doesn't it?
And I was like, well, here's my two cents.
You need a lot of scotch. That's how we should describe the podcast. If they ever went out and recruited one more person, then we'd have double the number of people listening.
Well then, let's start the show. Hello and welcome, everyone. Welcome to the show. I am one half of the hosting team, Brad, a.k.a. Flash, a.k.a. the doctors in the house. I don't know. We'll have to work on that.
There is only one of us that's the doctor, so yeah, I'll let you have that title.
That's right. Well, and then you just heard my the other half of the hosting team, Brad, a.k.a. British Brad, a.k.a. owner and keeper of Tabby Bruce, podcast mascot, a.k.a. the Big Strawberry.
Wow.
Is that one we can add to the list?
Yeah, well, yeah, we might as well. So, yeah, howdy, listeners. As Flash is alluding to, I had a dalliance with some science at the weekend. I let my immune system run right and had an anaphylactic reaction to something or other.
I think it was the prawns.
Well, it could have been one or two of the prawns. So I think before we start, I should probably just say, and I've already done this on Twitter, but I would definitely say thank you to the team of paramedics and the nurses and the doctors at the hospital that dealt with my puffy, histamine-ravaged, hive-ridden, blood pressure-lowering body. and thank them for all their assistance, because today would have been a slightly different show otherwise.
Yeah, we could have been doing the look back.
I can only imagine what that montage would look like. Oh my God.
An audio montage. And am I mistaken? Is this episode 25?
Is this quarter of a century? I'm not sure, actually.
Jesus, we really should have checked that before we started rolling. Let me take a quick look here. Because then it could be a number of milestones we have.
Well, it could be. Who would have thought to be honest, the fact that we're even in the 20s, I think, is an achievement.
Yeah. This is episode 25, my friend. So,
oh, well, round of applause for us.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, and well done to those listeners that have stuck with us all this time. I think we probably brought some in later on in the game. I think we probably lost a few during the journey.
Yeah. If you've listened to all 25, then, you know, hats off. Sorry.
Yeah, we should give some sort of award if you listen to all 25, like a badge or something. Or
I think we should send them pictures of your big swollen red face, because those were quite funny. They might not have gone viral yet, but that could be the secret insider club. You get a picture of.
I did like the reaction of some of our friends that were like, you couldn't get the paramedics to take more pictures while you were led on the kitchen floor getting treated.
Yeah. We could see the progression of it all. Well, we're glad you're here, man, because we got at least another 24 episodes in us, I think, before this thing totally falls off the rails, right?
I'd like to say it's like the Japanese bullet train, but I think it's more like a runaway train going into dark territory that may or may not come out the other side. But
well, let's give ourselves a pat on the back, a toast for 25. Thank you to the listeners. Thank you, my friend. Thank you.
And you, sir.
And let's move into some straight Olympic smack talk.
Oh, I knew this was coming.
you brought it up in episodes past, I believe, in our year opening special. You brought up that you were excited about the Olympics, and I will say, you've been to Canada now a couple times. You're practically Canadian. You're just missing the piece of paper, so you can be on our adopted. Because I noticed conspicuously that in the top 16, I'm not seeing Great Britain. I'm not seeing you guys. I don't know if you just didn't have the money, to put to forth the team this year, or just not performing as you thought it would?
I think you'd have to look a lot further down that medal table than 16 before you you found the road. But no, I feel as if Canada is my adopted home nation. You know, after you know getting to know you and having been to the Olympic Park in Calgary first time I came. So yeah, I feel as if I'm I get a share in the spoils that Canada will invariably take. I can't say that I'm fully on board with understanding all the rules of hockey other than smack the shit out of the opponent.
That's a good start.
Try and put the puck into the opposition net. But I think that's all you need to know, isn't it?
That's basically it, yeah.
And you could balance on skates, I'd be an Olympic athlete. But
you were telling me that you got into some curling. You were watching some curling the other day too. And I mean, that's big. You got hockey, curling, figure skating. This is our jam. Well, this is what Canadians are excited about.
And historically, the Brits haven't been too bad at curling. Well, yeah. I say the Brits, primarily led by the Scottish. Yeah. But obviously when they're winning, they're British. I was watching the Swiss versus the OAR today. And the OAR were a married couple. So it's funny because on the penultimate throw, Mrs. OAR threw.
Yeah, Mrs. Olympic athlete from Russia.
Yeah. And... It looked a good throw to me, but she wasn't happy. Her husband wasn't happy. The coaching staff didn't look happy. Commentators slagged it off. I thought it looked good, but yeah. Fine. And then the husband basically had it all to play for. So he could either go for the win, or he could try and get 2 points,
or go for the
draw and push it into an extra end or whatever they're called.
Yeah.
And he screwed it up as well. So if they're not getting divorced, then they're probably murdering each other right now. So.
Yeah, it's interesting though. This is a new. I think they're trying to keep curling fresh and hip, making it modern by dropping it down to this two person mixed doubles format, which I have yet to see. And as I said off air, I'm a traditionalist. I don't like this men and women playing together, two aside. Uh-huh. I want them separated. Four aside. Well, I want the game to last 4 hours.
At least this couple were married, Flash, you know.
Yeah. No, I think it's cool. It's one of those things because curling is like when you have the whole four to a side, the traditional way of playing curling, it can take a while. It's one of those sports that if you got a cold beer with you, multiple cold beers with you, it's great. It's awesome. It's something to have on while you're drinking.
I tend to find that most sports are improved for the spectator if there are a couple of beers involved based on my limited application.
Yeah, exactly. But this new curling format, I guess it speeds up the game. It's cool that it's mixed, mixed doubles. You get men and women playing together. I think that's cool. The American team looks like it's, I don't know, they look like they're just like a couple siblings or something.
Oh, really?
From Michigan or something. Like the guy's wearing a ball cap all the time. Because Canadian curlers, we always like, they try to look good, They try to look professional, right? Because curling's a big deal here. And then these Americans come along and it looks like the guy just stepped out of the pub, shirts untucked, ball cap on. Like, come
there
on,
should
man.
Should be rules against that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Show some respect. That's what I want to say.
Yeah, so I watched some curling. I watched a little bit of the women's slope style snowboarding.
That's a fun one.
Yeah, that was great to watch. Although there was obviously some controversy around the high winds. So
yeah,
and I kind of get I don't get why they cancelled the slalom because of high wind when those are basically people stuck to the snow.
Yeah,
at ground level as opposed to people that are jumping 40 feet in the air where wind probably is going to have more of an issue. Yeah. They let go on, but great as a spectator sport. Fantastic to watch a few crashes and spills. But.
Yeah, totally. This is why it's like I really liked watching ski jumping, like the distance ski jumping, but not modern day distance ski jumping. If you find on YouTube the like jumps from like the 70s, the equipment wasn't as good. There's a lot more air movement going on. It's like nowadays it's so smooth. It's like they barely even they barely even touch down.
They glide, don't they? It's like they've got those flying squirrel suits on. But and I think we've touched on. I swear we've touched on it before. Of course, when you bring up ski jumping, that era, or maybe in the pushing into the 80s, then of course you're touching on the era of Eddie the Eagle Edwards.
That's true.
The British ski jumper. So
we give you that. He could be up there in the pantheon of, you know, people that just wanted to make the Olympics for some reason. The Jamaican bobsled team, you know, all these guys.
I did see a great video earlier, if I find it, tweet it out, of the I think it's the Norwegian team. They've been trying to recreate within the Olympic Village, so not actually out on the slopes or anything, key Olympic moments. So the bit that I saw was... then recreating Cool Runnings using a pallet truck in what looks to be like underground stadium or something, yeah. And then like doing the run and then shooting down this.
Yeah.
If I find the video, I'll tweet it out. I think it was the BBC were like putting a compilation together. It was pretty funny.
Oh, those crazy Norwegians. You know, they're much like Canada in that like this is where we get to shine because we're one of few nations that is, you know, can afford winter sports. Winter sports notoriously expensive. We have snow a lot of the year, so like
that, this well, is that our, kind of helps.
Yeah. Yeah, this is our time to shine. The Summer Olympics, you will not see us in our pale skin showing up, you know, in big numbers. But Winter Olympics, this is our time to shine, baby. And if you look at the standings, those damn Norwegians are on top. Probably why they're having a good time recreating all these moments.
They can afford the time off.
Exactly. Yeah. You got Germany in second, though. And Germany has the most gold medals, too. So my ranking is looking at it right now, not in terms of who has the most gold, but overall medals. Okay. You got Norway, Germany, Netherlands, Canada. So we're in the top four. The U.S. is right behind us. But Germany has the most gold with four. Wow. The Netherlands has three. Canada should be up there. We missed out on a couple. We missed out on some speed skating medals that we were kind of hoping to win. And what else? I think, yeah, that was where a couple of the disappointments hit. Otherwise, we're hitting the ones that we're supposed to. So everything's on track. And to be honest, if we win the hockey tournament, the nation is happy. That's all we really need to do.
With your team of Ranghamters. So, yeah, I wish Team GB luck, but I also wish Team Canada luck. Yeah.
And apparently we got in a fight. We got in a fight with the Russians in the Olympic Village. So,
well, if you're going to get into a fight, who else are you going to get into a fight with? So,
Canada surprisingly has a pretty big rivalry in winter sports with Russia. I guess not surprisingly, but it dates back to the Cold War and the hockey rivalry. But since then, we've developed quite a good rivalry in the Olympics and the winter sports with Russia and our fearsome drug testing enforcer, head of the IOC, Dick Pound. Has been
such a great name.
He's
isn't it?
Been a thorn in the side of those cheating Russians for a while. So I think there's some animosity blowing over, and it appeared there was a brouhaha. Canadian coaches apologized and tried to settle it down, but I could tell, being a fellow Canadian, that the apology was really a guised "fuck you" to the Russians.
Well, you know, and at least he was a thorn in the side as opposed to a needle in the vein. But you know,
that's right. That's right. All right. Well, we got another week, I think, of Olympics, so we can touch
is
on it.
Yeah, is it just 2 weeks? Is that
it's like... really just 2 weeks? Yeah. So okay. by this time next week, it will all be said and done. And so next episode 26, we can do a recap and see how we all fared. I don't expect Canada to come out on top, but.
Crazy. Probably higher up the table than Team GB. I think that's
if we don't get like a top 10, that would be crazy.
Really? You're not going to be shooting? I always thought you'd be shooting for like top 5.
Yeah, we should. But I know when we had them in Vancouver in 2010, it was our highest showing. And I can't remember. I think we might have won overall, but we didn't have the most gold medals or vice versa. I can't remember. Anyway. Right. Yeah, but surprisingly, we don't really ever do that well. We win hockey and figure skating. There's a couple of things that we always win, but then, you know, like the sliding, the luge, the cross-country skiing, you'd think that we would do better at that, but we don't. Anyway, we'll see. We'll see.
Well,
I'm just, you know, typical Canadian downplaying downplaying as, oh, yeah, you know, we might win. We might. If we don't. At least the boys tried. The gals tried. So good on them.
Well, you say you're talking there, but you're not there in your Mountie outfit right now with your hockey stick in one arm and a Labatt's cold one in the other, or whatever beer it is you guys drink.
Molson.
Molson. Is Labatt's just Canadian, wasn't it? Or was that just a British-Canadian marketing spin?
No, it was Canadian. Labatt was Canadian. I think both have since been bought by other companies. Right. But Molson and Labatt were Canadian, yes.
Right, okay.
Yeah. Well, you are correct, sir.
Well, I'm correct, but you're not drinking either of them. So
it's tough to get them shipped over here.
Well, I'm sure there's probably a black market there somewhere. But.
All right, well, let's move on to then, the meat and potatoes here.
Okay.
The meat and potatoes of this show, episode 25. This is technically a science show, I guess. Or is it more of like a lifestyle show?
I don't think they could ever call us a lifestyle. So, but then I'm not sure they would. Well, they probably could call you, obviously, you're the doctor. So they could definitely call you a scientist, but probably not me. So
former. I'll say former scientist.
The scientist formerly known as former scientist.
Yeah. But we also, this is the first audience request that we've gotten to cover this story.
It is.
So we got an audience.
We were both so keen that we didn't speak to each other. We went off and researched it.
Yeah. So instead of having the normal two stories apiece, we have one shared one that we should know this really well, Brad. If we fuck it up, what does that say about us?
This is going to go one of two ways. Either we've researched it all from the same articles and we're just going to be reciting to the points, or it's going to turn into a battle. Well, I read
I'm going to go more with the former. But
okay.
It is an audience request. We got the request via Instagram. So yeah, we were
which
tagged.
Is
we
one
were
of the newer social medias for us.
Yeah. So it works, people. If you reach out to us, we will talk about it.
We've picked up that torch.
Yeah.
It was burning, but we've kept that fire going. Maybe even put a bit more fuel on it.
That's right.
Well, maybe once we come to the end of the story, we'll see if we put more fuel on it. But,
that's right.
We're holding the torch aloft and brightly.
Well, seeing as how we both researched this, do you want to give it a go, and then I'll interrupt you when I disagree.
No pressure. This feels like some sort of radio quiz show. Now, yeah. Right? No pause, no hesitation, no repeating yourself. So the story that we were sent in was about a cancer vaccine, which has been shown to eliminate tumors in mice. So this was coming out of Stanford University?
Correct, yeah.
In the US? Okay, I'm okay so far. That's good. And basically the principle behind this is a team of scientists there or researchers there have taken two immune-stimulating agents and inject those direct into tumors. And what they found is it eliminated all trace of those tumors. But not just the direct tumors, it also then spread and included any metastases from those tumors. So the tumors that spread from the primary site. Some of the benefits of using this local application would be that it's potentially cheaper than system-wide chemotherapy. But it also potentially should cause, they think, less side effects because you're injecting it locally as opposed to giving it systemically. And because you're giving it locally, then you're not activating the widespread immune system. So one of the reasons it's a bit safer. There are some immunotherapies on the market already, some that activate certain immune cells, some that block some immune pathways. And I think there's the most recent one that came out last year was the one where they actually take cells from the patient, modify them, and then put them back into the patient.
You can see how these have some issues around them. If you're trying to just jack up the whole immune system to fight off tumors, you got a hyperactive immune system. You got all the threats of inflammation and stuff that normally comes with overactive immune system or autoimmune disease.
Are you having a dig at my immune system after this weekend? Is that what you're doing there? All right, I'm a little bit oversensitive, both in my immune response and my humor there.
Yeah, you're definitely oversensitive to something. Prawns is my guess.
Yeah, well, yeah, probably my guess as well. The prawns are fighting back. The two agents that they used, one is actually already approved and on the market for humans, and the other is going through clinical trials at the moment. Based on the results from this study and some other studies, they've actually now started a clinical trial in human lymphoma patients using this this dual therapy. That started in January, so a little bit early at the moment. But the way it works is usually the T cells, which I know we've talked about before, a couple of episodes back, part of the immune system, they recognize foreign proteins or abnormal proteins in cancerous cells. So the body will try and mount an immune response against the cancer. But what usually happens is, as that cancer grows, it devises a way to escape that immune response.
Yeah, it can shut down the activity of the T cells that have targeted it. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So what this dual agent does is, the first agent that you give is basically a short DNA sequence, which is called CPG. Oh, go on.
Yeah, this is the stuff that they're injecting directly into the tumors.
Yeah. So the first one they inject is this DNA sequence, short sequence called CPG oligonucleotide.
Lovely name.
Yeah, it rolls off the tongue nicely. And basically what that does, from my limited understanding, is it works with other immune systems that are already, immune cells that are already present, and it amplifies a surface protein called OX40 or OX40 on the surface of T cells that are already there, and it activates the receptors. And then the second agent you're giving is the antibody, and then that binds to this OX40, which effectively then activates that T cell. And then specifically then targets that T cell against the cancer cells that are there. But because you've directly injected it, those T cells effectively are then pre-screened by the body only to be active against that cancer-specific protein. Whereas if you give it on a more widespread, potentially it's going to go off and search out this receptor everywhere else.
Yeah. Is the issue. I think this is the really important, the really important thing about this therapy. We've talked in a lot, I think, in the last couple episodes about these immunotherapies and really directing the immune system, or using, you know, immune cells that are already, they're already disease fighting things, and really applying them to new diseases or new problems and stuff. And it's like it's a pretty big thing in the medical world right now, this precision medicine. You might hear stuff about precision medicine and immunotherapy. And like you alluded to and talked about in the description there, this isn't really a new thing. Like, they have these immune therapies, but nothing so directed, nothing so targeted. And I think that's important, because it's like, when you start manipulating the immune system is so strong. There's so, like, it can kill you just as well as it can kill the diseases that are inside of you, right? Like, this is autoimmune disease, allergic reactions, all this stuff, right? So it's a really kind of complex system with a lot of potency, that if you start messing around with it, it can be, you know, you got to be very careful, or there can be really bad side effects, right? So this is really interesting, because you have these T cells, like you were describing, and they recognize the tumor. So they've already been, you know, your immune system will find foreign agents in your body, and they bind to them, and it like makes like an imprint on these cells. And then these cells divide, these T cells divide, but they all have this imprint. So they're all primed and targeted to go after this specific thing that they've identified. So you have all of this basically this army of these cells that are ready to go at this tumor, and then they get turned off, and this injection just turns them right back on. So they only go after that specific tumor that they've been primed for. And that's really, really cool. And did you read the how they kind of tested that specificity within the mice? Yeah. Because so they were doing the trials for this have all been done in mice, right? But they were actually transplanting tumors into mice. So they take, okay, I don't know, I guess they grow lymphoma tumors somewhere else and then they transplant them into mice. So in two different locations, and they would treat only a single tumor, but yet both tumors would disappear. And this is how they figured that it's like they have this army of T cells, you stimulate it, and then they can release through the body, but they're only going to attack that specific tumor that they've been, you know, like you said, pre-screened or primed or whatever term you want to use for. And so then they did it with not just lymphoma, they did it with breast cancer, colon cancer, maybe one other type, a melanoma, I believe. And it all worked. It worked just the same. If you have two tumors, you treat one, they both go away. But then they put two lymphomas and a colon cancer in one mouse. So three tumors, two.
Smash is having a pretty bad day, isn't he?
Yeah, it's the good of science, for the good of science. So they put these two. So you got two tumors of one type, one of another type, all residing in the same animal. You treat one of the lymphomas, both lymphomas disappear, but the colon cancer stays.
Right.
So it's targeted. It's very, very specific. It's very, very targeted. And that's important because you're not going to have these jacked up immune cells attacking other parts of the body. Right. But what it also means, and like you said, is that you can kill two tumors or multiple tumors that have come from the same source. And this is a big problem with cancer, is you have a tumor and then the term is metastasizing, where it breaks off and spreads to other parts of your body. And so even when you do surgery, if you don't get all of the tumor or it's already metastasized and you don't know about it, it's just going to pop up somewhere else. So you're constantly, you're constantly having to either treat the whole body with chemotherapy or whatever, or be going in multiple surgeries, picking these things out as they pop up. Whereas the doctor behind this theory was saying he envisions a world in which you get a tumor, you inject it with this immune boosting shot before you remove it with surgery. And that way, if you don't get it all or it's already metastasized,
you've already whacked it.
Yeah, these immune cells will spread through your body and get them. He also thinks that it could be in certain cancers where you have a genetic source of the cancer, like a genetic mutation. So even if you remove a tumor, that genetic mutation will mean that as you live, you will develop more tumors. This is where the vaccine idea comes in, because if you develop a tumor, you hit it with this, you take that tumor out, even if your body develops another one from the same mutation, some of the breast cancers are like that, then
still got this thing.
Yeah, it'll catch it before it even goes. Because they did this, they did a test in mice. So there's a certain genetic line of mice that has been altered to be highly susceptible to tumors. So they develop tumors really fast.
Yeah.
And they're used as a model for cancer. And they did this. So they gave, like, as soon as they developed a tumor, and it was in the mammary, so it was like a breast cancer model. And if you don't know, mice have multiple teats, like 10 of them.
I think I read.
Yeah, 10 of them. So you expect cancer popping up in all of these. But if they treat that first one, it actually prevented the other ones from even forming. So a lot of times they never even saw other ones, or same thing. You could treat it, remove it, and it would stop metastasizing growth. So, I mean, that's pretty crazy. That's pretty cool.
For me, it was the numbers, because normally when you read about these studies, it's done in, we've done it in two mice, and we've seen a response. So, I saw the piece about the breast cancer one, and the lymphoma mice, they did it in 90 mice.
Yeah.
90 is still not a huge number, but they had 87 cured immediately, and then the three that weren't, they then give a second dose, and those three regressed. Tumors regress as well.
Well, I could be wrong, but I believe it was three of the 87 that were cured. They were cured, but they just, like, the tumor came back. Yeah, right. And they just, like, gave them another whack, and it was gone again. So,
yeah, they're not massive numbers, but they're not down in the low digits that normally with a lot of these things.
Yeah,
you hear, especially with the media, you hear that banded around. So. Yeah, interesting. Obviously, there's some limitations in terms of depending on where the cancer is, having to reach it. So, you know, do you have to?
Yeah.
In some cases, do you use surgery to use the direct injection, or can you, ultrasound guided, needle placement, whatever? So, I guess that's going to be a limitation. But
I guess. Yeah, I didn't think of that. I was like, your body's only so thick. We can get a needle.
You
big
can
enough.
Get a needle.
You can get a needle big enough. It's just
that you say that to all the girls, don't you?
Yeah. It's not going to be comfortable, but there's a needle big enough.
Now you're just making these jokes too easy, Flash. But yeah, some really, and I feel sometimes we seem to follow, there seems to be trends in there. I think the last couple of episodes we have, nailed this. Nailed is probably the wrong term, because I don't think we've nailed it. I don't think we'd ever call ourselves immunologists and certainly not oncologists. But it, you know, it does seem to be where there's, you know, a growing field of research.
Yeah.
With, you know, some positive news coming all of a sudden. So
yeah.
Yeah, one to watch for the future for sure.
Yeah, well, and maybe we need to take a look at the other side, because I have been seeing some rumblings on Twitter from some skeptics, some health skeptics, who generally, you know, try and go through media around health discoveries and tone down some of the enthusiasm that the media likes to push on some of these stories. You know, the old, the cure is just around the corner, 10 years away. That was 10 years ago. You know what I mean? That kind of stuff. And there is some issue with how much certain companies, physicians, whatever, are hyping this precision medicine idea. I mean, I'm not to conflate that with this story specifically. I'm just saying there is another side to this immunotherapy stuff, and maybe that's, maybe that'll be coming up in episode 26. Hint, hint. I don't know.
Who knows? Well, and I remember when I was doing biology at college in Louis, you know, a long, long time ago, they, you know, a lot of the talk then was about the magic bullet, about, you know, monoclonal antibodies being used for, you know, chemotherapeutic agents and things, mm-hmm. which, you know, yes, are there, but I think we were a long way away from where we are now. We've moved towards the better.
Yeah.
But that was, you know, that was almost like 20 years ago. So, you know, these things aren't quick, are they? But
no, they take forever, especially once you're trying to move from mice models into human practice, right? And I wonder too, like, so with this story specifically, they talked about how they transplanted the tumors in. And to me, that seemed weird. I wasn't sure why they were doing that. And does that somehow, you know, influence the result, maybe for the better? Like, maybe that's another way of showing how it's specific, because these tumors came from another source. So,
well, presumably they must have had control animals, otherwise you would think if they've transplanted tumors in, whatever they transplanted to, the host is then going to mount an immune response against the non-host type tissue anyway.
Well, so this is what I'm wondering.
There must have been a control of, and these mice we didn't treat yet, they were transplanted. And
Yeah. Or if they're deriving the tumors just outside of the body, but with the same mouse tissue. Yeah, I don't know. But it just seemed, that seemed, like, everything seemed really nice about this story, but there was a couple things like that where I was like, why would you do that? Like, I don't, because you have these mice that are bred to get tumors, which they used in one. But I guess that's a specific type of tumor. It's the breast one, and if you want to test other cancers.
Well, I guess there's that, and I guess also if you use those mice, you don't potentially know how many cancers have they got.
Yeah.
You know, whereas if you take a normal mouse and, you know, transplant in two tumors, okay, there's a chance that mouse has naturally got cancer, but chances are you've transplanted in two tumors, that mouse has two tumors.
Yeah, exactly. You could be more specific, I guess.
But I hadn't read that's how they did it. So yeah, I'll go in after the show and have a look at that, and just, yeah, that would be interesting. Well, I have done it that way.
Yeah, well, for the audience, you could check the show notes on the website and dig into it yourself as well, because Lord knows we can't do everything for you. We're just raising the questions.
Yeah, well, I think we've had a pretty good stab at, you know, taking the question and throwing a few answers out there. It's definitely an interesting story, so thank you for sending it in.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Right on. Moving on.
You want to stick on this jolly topic?
Yeah. Love to.
Okay, well, so sticking with the cancer theme. So there was an article, and I think I may have already tweeted this out. If I haven't, then it will come out with the show notes. That certain food types can alter the spread of cancer. Now, I think there's been, for a long time, you know, it's been known that certain types of food, so, you know, or certain ways of cooking food maybe predispose you to other health assets, you know, frying things with heart disease, whatever, and maybe burning things on a barbecue and the charcoal maybe potentially causing cancer. But there was a paper published recently in the Nature journal, highlighting some research that actually came out of Cambridge, so not a million miles away from me, out of the Cancer Research UK laboratories here. So it's some animal research looking at breast cancers. And what they've shown in certain breast cancers is that the cancers struggle to progress without a certain type of amino acid. The amino acid itself is asparagine, which, as its name might give away, is found predominantly in asparagus.
It's the one it's the specific amino acid that makes your pee sting.
Yeah.
Don't quote me on that. Then, I don't know if that's true.
I'm not sure if it is that amino acid, but yeah, you know, obviously asparagus is also known for that as well. Say anything with confidence, Flash, people will believe it.
Yeah.
So it's found in asparagus. You also find it in poultry and seafood as well. You find it in some other food types as well, but those are the main ones. And what they found is in the mice that they had with this aggressive form of breast cancer, they usually, untreated, died within 2 weeks, usually because the cancer itself spread beyond just the breast cancer site. What they found is if they gave these mice diets that were low in asparagine or gave them drugs that blocked asparagine or mopped up asparagine, the tumor struggled to spread. There was that, and that was done in Cambridge. There's also been some other work alongside that, as I was digging into that, University of Glasgow, showing that some other amino acids, so serine and glycine, if you cut those in the diet, then that slowed the progression of lymphoma and some intestinal cancers as well. So there seems to be some sort of link. And the thought behind it is that, especially with asparagine, it's already been shown that asparagine has a role, and they're not exactly sure what that role is yet, in the metastases process. So the process we talked about earlier, if you have a primary cancer, say in the breast, and then a part of that will splinter out, go off in the bloodstream and implant itself somewhere else in another organ, and then cause another cancer. So there's a drug on the market already that's licensed, asparaginase, which is an enzyme which is currently used to treat a couple of types of leukemia and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And what that does is it actually breaks down any circulating asparagine before the tumor can get it and make use of it for the metastases. So that drug's already on the market.
So it soaks up so that it's not available for tumor use. Yeah,
exactly. So it sort of outcompetes the tumor, really. So although it's not curing the primary cancer, it's stopping the spread of the cancer, and then you can come in with one of the new chemotherapeutic agents or surgery or whatever, and do it. And it tends to be the metastases that is the big problem, because you, as we said before, you don't know where it's spread to.
Yeah.
So if you've got some way of blocking that spread, or at least mopping it up as much as you can, then
you can go a long way
in the fight.
Yeah. Great.
But what they are at pains to say is, don't stop eating asparagus.
I was just going to say, moral of the story, asparagus kills.
Well, I'm guessing there'll probably be some media outlets saying that.
Yeah.
If it doesn't kill you, it'll make you pee smell.
Yeah. And then we'll get big asparagus on our back.
Yeah.
Suing us for defamation.
Asparagus farmers petitioning outside our houses. And you know, they've naturally got spears. The fact they're made of asparagus is a different matter. But yeah, there you go. There's one. But yeah, so actually, you know, I mentioned the three type of foods there, but actually asparagine is in lots of different foods. So, you know, as with all diet, everything in moderation, and there's still a lot of work to be done to show that, you know, there's not other causes or factors beyond that. So, you know, I'm going to put that disclaimer in so that we're not getting lynched, sued, and having to check out their cars for asparagus spears and things.
By big asparagus. Yeah, interesting. It does kind of freak me out, though. Like, I hate hearing any of these studies that's like, your food might be linking to cancer in this way and this way. And it's just like, it just makes me just, you know, want to give up. It's like, well, I can't do anything. There's nothing I can do. So I'm just banking on these new cancer therapies to get super good, so that by the time it happens to me, I can at least be in a study group, you know, for the new cancer drug.
Well, and that's, you know, if you look at, like, there are certain, you know, if you look at some of the, obviously the Western culture has higher incidence of heart disease and certain types of cancers compared to the Eastern world, part of that being down to diet and climatic conditions and whatever. So it's always been there.
Yeah.
And as you said, you know, you can't live your life in a box. You've got to get out there and do things. But, and I'm sure there's probably natural nutrients, vitamins and minerals and other amino acids in asparagus and evil seafood. After my brush with death this weekend, not that I'm over-egging that at all, and poultry, this is probably good for you and probably blocks cancer and other diseases in other ways. So then you have this yin and yang of, well, am I more at risk of cancer because then I wouldn't eat this, or am I more at risk of this disease, in which case I probably should eat it. But,
yeah, exactly. I mean, it's like, I guess it's like you said, everything in moderation. This makes me think too of just, and I don't have all the details on it because I wasn't prepared to talk about this, but I'm going to talk about it anyway.
When's that ever stopped you?
It really hasn't. It really hasn't. They found a link between estrogen and it actually stopped these certain type of cells or cancer cells from progressing into cancer. But help them turn into neural cells, some sort of nervous system tissue, so, you know, and it's like, I've heard the opposite, right? That estrogen can be a cause of some kind of cancers, higher levels of estrogen, you know, so just my point here being that it's like you said, like it's one thing could do one in one situation could be bad, in another situation could be good. You could be taking one thing that's doing something bad, but at the same time having something that's counteracting that. That's part of you. Like, there's so many pathways that we just don't know. But I don't know. I'm just going to keep doing what I'm doing. I think the main thing that we can say with cancer is don't smoke. That's a surefire one. There's not a study out there that's like, well, actually.
Well, there probably are some studies out there. Maybe those sponsored ones. By certain tobacco companies. But yeah, I would say you're probably safe to say you can cut smoking out without any ill effects, you know, other than having withdrawal symptoms and maybe some depression from the lack of nicotine and things.
But you're probably
safe to say that on Flash. So yeah, podcast fact right there. Quit smoking to lower your risk of cancer. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not sure we can claim the uniqueness on that one. I think others may have come before us on that one.
Hey, I'm just doing my part, public service announcement.
Well, that's true, yeah. So the 8 listeners that we have now are aware of that fact. So potentially we've saved 8 lives.
If you weren't already, some guy right now taking a... Are you shitting me? Nobody told me. Nobody told me. He's like, puts it out, thanks. We're going to get an email that's just like, shit, thank you guys.
Do you think that's the real listenership base that we're going to, the sort of person that doesn't know that smoking increases your risk of cancer? Because we're going far too highbrow with some of our topics. We need to be setting the bar a lot lower, my friend.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Oh, well. All right. Well, I guess this wraps up the cancer portion of the show.
You're welcome, people. Yeah. That's cancer done. Not literally, we haven't cured it. Although, you know, Flash and I are willing to take a degree of royalties for any future cure for cancer.
That's right. So we'll move on. The final story of the show. Let me get my notes.
I know we're trying to milk this show out based on the lack of stories we've got, but, you know, oh, let me find my note. Oh, hold on, they're over there. Oh, no, I've dropped them.
Intermission break.
Ice cream's available from the foyer.
No, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go.
Okay.
I've been ready to talk about this my whole life, basically, because I grew up with siblings. I know you didn't have the pleasure of growing up with siblings.
Well, my parents told me they couldn't improve on perfection, so they were one and done.
Oh, God. They would say that, wouldn't they?
Well, that's what they said to my face. I did overhear them at a dinner party saying, we have one, and that was a fucking laugh. I presume that was in a good way. I don't know.
Exactly. No, so this story I'm bringing to us now is about sibling bullying. So, thankfully, I got along with my siblings fairly well.
That means you were the one beating the crap out of them, isn't it?
No. I'm the middle child. I was just surrounded by all the chaos, trying to calmly make my way through, unfazed. You know, I wanted to get noticed because, you know, classic middle child syndrome. But, no, my brother and sister were the ones that they were always at each other. I kind of stayed out of it, you know? But
you're like the UN in between, were you?
Exactly. Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. But it turns out, according to said research, sibling bullying during childhood, so kids that are bullied by their siblings during childhood, are 3 times more likely to develop a psychotic disorder in young adulthood. So psychotic disorders being the big one, schizophrenia. So okay. Psychotic disorders are disorders where you lose touch of reality, get confused, hallucinate, delusional. Bipolar is another one. Your mood changes. Your personality changes.
So just go through it. So if there was sibling bullying, you're more predisposed to this or the other way around?
The first. Children that are bullied by their siblings, and actually,
yeah,
they did find an increase as well. So it didn't really matter if you were the victim or the perpetrator. If you just involved in bullying, you were 3 times more likely to develop one of these psychotic disorders. You're 4 times more likely to develop this disorder if you're bullied by your siblings and your classmates at school.
Okay, I was going to ask if there was there another group of
people? Yeah, there's a compound effect if you're getting it all the time. There's a compound effect.
Well, that's fairly understandable. Yeah,
Yeah, I can imagine the stress of it all. And like I said, my siblings were great, and they fought with each other, but you know, both are fine. As of the recording of this show, I know of no psychotic disorder.
That's a matter of conjecture and opinion, I would say, that that's having met both your siblings and having met your good self.
Yeah,
but, I'm not going to side with one of the Van Paradens over another. Yeah. So.
You don't want to try and divide us either, because we'll come at you.
Well, exactly. I don't want to be bullied and then go on to get some psychosis or whatever.
That's right. So the way they did this is they took 3,600 children. They completed
and bullied the shit out of them.
Yeah, they just bullied them. Just
love to see the ethics review for this one.
Yeah, it wasn't even that the researchers couldn't bully them. They got them together with their siblings and gave the siblings rewards for bullying their siblings.
No way.
No.
Okay.
that would be something else. They enrolled 3,600 children in this longitudinal, long-term study. They fill out a questionnaire about sibling bullying when they're at about the age of 12, and then they do a follow-up psychological exam at the age of 18 and find out how many of them developed some kind of a psychotic disorder, and then you use stats, etc., to come up with your likelihood, your odds, all that stuff. So it was only like 55 of the 3,600 children actually developed a psychotic disorder. So I don't know. It's one of these things that I wonder. It's like you hear these numbers like 3 times more likely. You're 3 times more likely to develop a psychotic disorder. Then you look at the numbers and it doesn't. It's like 3,600, 55 of those. So, always a note of caution there. But the specific numbers on the bullying I kind of found interesting too, and I'll look those up right here. So of the adolescents, 664 were victims of sibling bullying. 486 children were pure bullies to their siblings, meaning they weren't bullied themselves. They were the purest of the pure bullies. And 771 children were bully victims. So this means that they were both victimized and bullied. So those were the total numbers out of the 3,600. This is the level of bullying that we're dealing with. So it's a lot. I mean, that's almost half. I'm just kind of doing math that I'm not very good at, but we'll say it's about half.
Kind of running out of fingers that part, aren't you?
Yeah, exactly. So it's kind of, and if you think about it, like, there's a lot of bullying, and it's one of these things that I think, like, sibling bullying and the study researchers said this too. It's like, you think about bullying at school, and there's a big push right now for bullying at school to be recognized and, interventions towards that, but you kind of forget about your siblings in the family setting because it's more, they're siblings. Siblings fight, you know, whatever. It's less, but they're saying like, hey, there actually could be long-term, you know, effects to this. And the fact that kids are with your, when you're with siblings, you're confined to the house. Like you have to hang out with those people. So there's no escape, at least school, you know, you can kind of escape or find new friends or you try and do things, but your siblings, you're really stuck. So it's kind of interesting to think of that. And then it was, yeah, so the kids that were like most likely to have developed mental issues were the victims. So the victims were more likely. So even the perpetrators had some effect as well, but the victims are most likely to develop psychotic disorders. So, and even if you're a perpetrator and a victim, you've kind of fallen into the victim category. And then, like I said, those with, that are bullied both at school and at home. Thought that jumps into my head is also they didn't look at, you know, what I guess what you would call child abuse. But if a parent is also bullying, I wonder if it's the same effect. I imagine it would be.
Yeah, I would have thought so. And I was wondering if, obviously you mentioned bipolar and schizophrenia and stuff, and I know people instantly jump to like the multi-personality disorder and, yeah, and things like that. But in effect, it's like an altered perception of reality. And I wonder if is part of that the body trying to protect itself by creating
like a disassociation.
A disassociation to it. So within, you know, you're bullied in this part of the world,
yeah,
within your mind, but not in that part.
I don't know. Yeah.
Was the study all done? The 3,600 whatever family, was it all in one part of the world, or was it a,
yes,
global study?
No, I believe it was all in one part of the world because they were recruited for this thing called the Avon Longitudinal Study of Parents and Children. So these longitudinal studies, as they call them, they generally get a group of children and the parents agree to it at birth or at a very young age, and they do a number of different, you know, tests like this, whether it's questionnaires, things like this, and then they follow this set of children from, you know, this county or city or whatever, for however many years. Some of the longest, I think, was some of the longest longitudinal studies have been done in New Zealand, and it's like they followed kids from birth to 25, 30 years of age.
You know? Yeah, there's a couple here. I know they've done some in twins here that have got, yeah, they've been going for like 20 years, and yeah, some in kids that have been going for 20 years.
Yeah,
so
they
throw out so much data.
Yeah, exactly. And they're never looking at just one thing. Like this study, they just had the bully questionnaire or whatever, you know. So they add it to this study, but I'm sure these kids are going to be used. The data from these kids are going to be used to publish a number of papers about a number of different things. Probably also some cancer stuff in there as well. They do blood testing at your regular doctor visits and stuff. So they're kind of interesting. These longitudinal studies are interesting in that way. But yeah, so I'm assuming that if they were recruited all to this one longitudinal study, they're going to be from the same area, at least county, right, or whatever. Yeah. And it was the University of Warwick, which I believe is in Northern England.
Warwick.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Sort of middle north, yeah.
Okay, so there you go. One thing that I really liked, because you know, in the last episode we talked about methodology behind studies and psychology studies in particular, and how we found it a bit dubious, but we're probably wrong because we're not scientists. I did like that the authors put in, like the researchers put this, made sure that this quote was in the press release, was that although we controlled for many pre-existing mental health and social factors, it could not be excluded that the social relationship problems may be early signs of developing serious mental health problems rather than their cause. So right. You acknowledge that it's like, it's not, you know, what came first. So it could
chicken
be
in the egg type scenario.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. So it could be that the bullying has led to the disorders, or the fact that you're having trouble with your siblings, whether you're being bullied or a bully, is somehow a sign of, you know, there's something already there that might lead to, Which is kind of weird to think about it when you say it out loud like that. Like, I'm just saying it out loud now for the first time. And I'm like, if you're being bullied, it's probably because you're a crazy person anyway. And you're not fitting in good.
I was going to put you down, but I don't want to be seen as bullying you, Flash. And then, you know, 5 years time, you're having some psychotic disorder and
some breakdown.
Me getting sued and the blame for it. Yeah, I don't want to get the blame for that. I couldn't take that responsibility. So I'm gonna sheathe my wit on that one. Doesn't happen very often. Make the most of it.
Yeah. No, I thought that was kind of. I mean, I like that's in there because, like I said about the methodology, sometimes of these things, you're always a little curious as to that. But so they did try to control for other factors that might be causing disease or mental disorder later in life. But I guess you never get the perfect answer. But bullying, man, there you go. And I mean, I used to always say that, like, there's a little bit of healthy bullying that goes on to socialize kids, you know?
Yeah, I think that. Yeah, I think you're right. I think there is. I think, bullying is wrong. And I know, touch wood, fortunately, as far as I'm aware, my daughter's not had it, but I know other people's kids that have, and it's just so tough to deal with. And I think there is an element of, well, you know, toughen you up for later life. But if it's just so unrelenting,
yeah,
it can have such a negative impact on people.
And that would be the interesting thing to note here, like to go deeper and like find this study and read the whole methods and the questionnaire and stuff, because I wonder what they label bullying, you know. That's the other thing, like what, like, and again, not just, you know, for the people out there, oh, bullying is wrong, it's all wrong, yeah, it all sucks, but like, is it, are we talking, you know, a mild taunting here and there, or are we talking you know, physical? Like, there's ranges, yeah. Right? Like, there's not just one behavior that can be called bullying. And I think they did in this somewhere in what I read, they talked about how they had, like, does it happen one to three times a week or something was sort of the... But again, what's the specific behavior? Is it purely words? Is it a mix of physical and words? Is it, you know, what is it? And could you find a... you know, a severity. So with an increased severity, we'll say, of the bullying, there's an increased risk. Who knows?
Right, yeah. Well, I hope the listeners aren't feeling bullied out there as we ram these facts at them. But,
What? Oh, the listeners can't handle it? Oh, what, you can't handle it? Oh.
Well, we've already accused them of, you know, potentially being so dumb that they don't know that smoking causes cancer, so... Thanks for sticking with us, listeners. Hopefully you're still tuned in to the end of episode 25 at this stage, and hopefully you'll tune into episode 26.
Yeah, and if you're about 12 years old and you're listening to this, good for you. Good for you. But yeah, you might be at risk. If you're above 18 and you haven't developed, you know, if you're like 23 and you haven't developed schizophrenia, I'm going to bully you because I think you're fine.
Yes. Spoken by the one doctor on the show. So
maybe there's a threshold where it's like you weren't bullied enough.
Well, then there is an interesting study.
Because like I said, this is what I kind of like said about the one I said, oh, I used to always say there's a healthy amount of bullying. Because you see, like, there must be some social role to, like, you know, children finding the norms and stuff and bonding as a group, like trying to fit in, right? And of course, bullying, of course, is wrong. We don't have to say it, but there's some kind of a socializing aspect to it. Like, if you're so weird that nobody wants to hang out with you, or, you know, or you're the kid, like, I always think of the stinky kid. You know, if you remember back to elementary school, there was always the stinky kid. And it's like, if you get teased a little bit about being stinky, you're going to wash, you're going to bathe. And some kids need that push to, you know, reinforce their hygiene habits.
I guess there's
a socialization
that's what I was going to say. That's what I was going to say. Whether you call it bullying or not, there's almost a socialization element of you find your place in the world and whatever. But then let's look at politicians. Here's an example then. So you look at politicians, one party in government and the other in opposition, and whatever the government say, the opposition berate them for, whether they're, you know, whether they're right or wrong, and vice versa. Now that actually is just bullying, in the playground.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm right. You know, my dad's definitely bigger than your dad. No, he's not. My dad could have your dad. No.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're just doing it on a different scale, aren't you? So yeah, I think healthy bullying, I think, is the wrong term, but socialization,
yeah,
I think is healthy. But I think, yeah, there has to be a cutoff point where,
yeah, when does it become the one thing and the other? And I bring this up kind of, in jest, because obviously there's a line. I think obviously you can tell when it's not helpful.
The old adage of sticks and stones will break my bones. That isn't helpful, I would say.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Bones being broken by sticks and stones, not helpful.
Yeah.
Names will never hurt me. Well, names after a while will hurt, if you throw enough of them.
And but might make you schizophrenic.
Well, there you go. So they should add on to that adage. Sticks and stones will break my bones. Names will never hurt me. And who said that?
That's
sorry, right. I feel as if I've just belittled the argument that we just made. But yeah.
And the other thing, too, is like... To try and justify some amount of bullying because one kid might have been the stinky kid and stopped being stinky because somebody, called him stinky kid.
It sounds a little bit close to you. Were you the stinky kid, Flash?
I was not the stinky kid, no. No.
Okay.
I experienced some bullying growing up. I think most people did.
Well, obvious for the face like yours. That goes without saying.
Yeah, ouch. There we go. Yeah. All right. Let's get into it. I like it. I think it's healthy. Yeah. I don't know. I just don't want to come across too callous there because obviously bullying is a big issue. And even in the household, like I said, you didn't grow up with siblings, but a lot of times, me and my siblings or hanging out with my cousins who you came from families where there's multiple siblings and you see how they treat each other. It's like, but it was always kind of washed over. It's just siblings. Like how many brothers do you know that just fight and fight and fight all growing up? Like I knew, me and my brother got along great. But we knew a number of sibling pairs that it was just like, and I was just like, how could you guys, like, how could you live in the same house? It looks like you're going to kill each other. So now I haven't followed up with them. Maybe one of them has turned into a schizophrenic since then. I don't know.
Maybe one of them's dead. Maybe he's killed the other one.
Yeah.
I felt like I got bullied by a rogue prawn at the weekend. So, I think I can relate a little bit. And, it has affected my psyche afterwards because now I'm terrified of eating certain foods. So,
yeah,
prawn one, Brad Neil for the time being. But I plan to fight back.
Yeah, well, you should. You got to stick up to a bully. You got to stand up to a bully. Yeah.
I plan to.
Don't let the prawns win. But if they do, more for me. So,
that's very true. Yeah, I certainly won't be diluting their numbers by eating as many of them as possible, which is normally my reaction to animals and things that have hurt me in the past. I'm a big lover of eating bacon because I'm normally attacked by pigs. but I can't return the favor to prawns now because they seem to have the upper hand on me and my immune system.
Well, we'll have to get immune therapies on there and see what we can do. See what this show can promote to
help. Maybe I could be a case study for immunotherapies for potential shellfish allergies. Who knows?
Dude, that'd be sweet. Well, I've never known a guinea pig before.
Well, I was going to say I could be the poster boy, but it would have to be a billboard the size that my head swelled up to get me on. So
the way your face looked,
Well, and I didn't think my nose could get any bigger. I was bullied at school having a big nose, but I found out the weekend it definitely can get bigger. So, and not in the Pinocchio sense. So,
Well, it will be in the Pinocchio sense when someone's like, "Brad, did you eat prawns?" No, I didn't.
Yeah, that tells us something. So should I summarize where I've been? Well, where I've been, where we've been on this?
Let's do it. Let's wrap her up.
Well, firstly, go Team Canada. Go Team GB. I think,
I can get on board with half that statement.
Well, no, as part of the Commonwealth, Flash, I think you should be on board with that because obviously I'll be supporting Team Canada in certain events. And I think maybe if there's an event, maybe where Canada aren't potentially in a winning position, and somebody from Team GB is maybe you want to get on board for that.
I find that very hard to do. And also there's a bunch of Australians kicking around these winter games that I'm not even sure why they're there, but they tend to have a pretty good team too, and I can't bring myself to do it. The more we're connected in this bond, the more I need to be the bully and win.
Well, you heard it first. Flash is a bully. Okay. Well, that wasn't where I wanted that summary to go, but okay. That's where it's landed. A bit awkward. Okay. Moving on. Cancer, the T cells are coming to get you.
That's right.
So you heard it here first, cancer.
Yeah.
You're going to get your ass kicked.
It's on the list now.
Yeah. And we're going to stop your spread by telling people to stop smoking.
That's right.
So yeah, cancer. But basically you and I, Flash, have put cancer on the back foot today.
That's right.
You know, we've saber rattled, we've warned it that the T cells are coming. And we've taken the legs out from stopping people from smoking.
You're welcome, world. Bill Gates, we're waiting for our Gates Foundation money to, you know, keep this message going, to enhance our signal, broadcast us to more places.
Just imagine what we could do with the Gates Foundation money behind us, Flash.
Yeah, I know. Save the world from cancer.
Well, that and, you know, have some nice cars and new laptops and
a couple cigars.
Sunny beach somewhere. Yeah, well, not cigars, Flash. That would defeat the object.
Right. I didn't realize the mics were still on.
No, and then I'd have to bully you for having cancer. Well, you caused it yourself, you idiot. And you're the stinky kid because you smell of cigar smoke. Could eating that or not eating that give you cancer? So, you know, be careful what you're eating. From here on in, I'd say I'm just going to eat steak.
Yeah.
You know, I was going to say I've never heard anyone dying of steak allergy, but actually there is that red meat allergy.
Yeah, isn't there? There definitely is.
Jeez. Okay. Okay. Well, I'll be living off of tofu and water from here on in. So you've got that to look forward to next time you're in close proximity to me, Flash.
Yeah.
So,
cranky, hungry guy.
Yeah, and last but obviously, bullying is bad, but you know, maybe it helps socialize you a little bit when you're younger. But on the whole, bullying is bad.
That's right.
That should be the take-home message.
That's right. And we have no evidence to support our other theory. So
no, exactly, we don't. So let's go with the evidence that's out there, as true scientists should.
Yeah.
Until we disprove or reprove what has or has not been proven.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Because I'm confused by that statement, but I think we're just going to leave that there.
Let's let that meatball hang out there and see how it works.
Yeah, let's do that. Flash, as always, it's been a pleasure. For those of you that want to reach out, as we've said, you know, one of today's stories came from somebody pinging us a message on Instagram. So Instagram, we're at @2Brad4You. If you can remember that, it's very easy to remember where we are on Twitter because we are exactly the same handle on Twitter.
That's right.
If you want to hit me directly, Britt Brad, up on Twitter, then it's @BradleyWHayes on Twitter. Flash, if people want to get in touch with you, bully you, maybe cyberbully you, send you story ideas, what should they do?
If people want to cyberbully me, bring it on. That's what I want to say. @BVampiridon. And I also want to encourage people to cyberbully the big red strawberry over sitting across from me.
Well, I was going to say, there's definitely, as you started this whole episode off with the smack talk about the Olympics, you know, heaven help you if and when Team GB win any sort of medal, because you will be getting cyber smacked with that, my friend, let me tell you.
Well,
in a public forum for all to see.
Until you make it into the top 16, that's the only list I have. The CBC on their website, Keeping Track of the Olympics, they only list the top 16. The rest don't matter. So until you make it up there, you can win, you know, bronze here or there, and I'll let you have it.
Oh, that's decent of you.
All right, man.
Flash, it's been a good one. Listeners, thank you. Yeah, as Flash said, episode 25. Wow. Who would have thought it?
I kind of had an inkling, but yeah, I wasn't sure if it would ever come to this.
I had hopes. I'll be honest, I had hopes and aspirations, but I didn't think it would happen. So I'm truly humbled and honoured. Flash, thank you. Listeners, thank you. And we'll probably catch you sometime soon.
Yeah, catch you all next time.
Till next time, take care.
Later.
I probably would want to touch on the Olympics straight off the bat. Just it's you know, Canada is now my adopted nation.
Does Great Britain even have anybody competing in the winter?
Hey, go fuck yourself. Well, yes, we do, because you'll notice that we won bronze at the last Olympics.
One bronze?
Bronze? So we won a bronze, was the first, I think it was the first, it's definitely the first medal in that sport. I think it was the first Winter Olympic gold we won in years. And then we won a gold in the skeleton or whatever it is. But actually, the girl that won bronze, I went to school with.
There you go.
I was just going to have a look.
I have the medal rankings up here from the CBC, but it's only the top 16. I only have the top 16.
Well, that's okay. If you're not in the top 16, you might as well fuck off, wouldn't you?
I'm not seeing Great Britain.
No, you won't. Yeah. Yeah. I include us in that.
Goddamn Norwegians.